Buongiorno, and welcome to the center of the Mediterranean. Around me, it's a Saturday morning, and the sleepy island of Malta is just starting to wake up. This place is home to only 500,000 people, although I guess that's 500,001 now, because we're about to meet its newest resident.
Hello, Andrew.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, good. How are you?
Good. Nice to meet you.
Wow, this place is amazing. I cannot believe you get to live here. How long have you been living in Malta for?
I just got here 2 weeks ago.
Fresh off the boat.
Yeah, totally. It was a short trip over, waiting for the family to join me, but it's been a bit of an adventure.
And whereabouts are you actually from?
I'm from Wellington, New Zealand.
Awesome. Kia ora.
Kia ora. Kia ora.
Two Kiwis. Yeah, it's funny that we're both from down under in New Zealand, and yet we've managed to meet up on almost the exact opposite side of the globe here in Malta.
Oh, totally.
Had you been to Malta before, or did you move here sight unseen?
It was sight unseen, but it was just a bit too challenging with the timing. 2 days to get over here, you got to juggle it with the kids' school holidays, 2 days to get back, it just wasn't really going to be practical. So yeah, we had the real estate agent going through apartments, showing us a video, and we chose it on that basis.
Wow, so you're the kind of person who will fly to the other side of the world, sight unseen, move the family over.
Well, sometimes you need to take a big step when one's called for, and this turned out to be it.
How are you feeling about that choice now? You're just a few weeks in.
You know, being in New Zealand, anytime you want to visit another country, sort of Australia's the closest, but it's several hours flight just to get there.
Yeah.
And anywhere further afield, much longer. Whereas here, we can jump on a plane in 2 hours, be half a dozen other countries, no sweat. My wife's from a Middle Eastern background, so one of the things we like about Malta is the local language has a lot of Arabic roots to it. And we've been trying to teach my kids Arabic for quite a while, but this will give them a bit more exposure to that side of things, which will fit in really well.
That's so cool, yeah, because when you look at Malta on a map, it really is in the middle of everywhere. It's an extraordinary vantage point.
Oh, totally. I'm expecting we're going to be making full use of that annual leave over here and going and jumping around, visiting all sorts of different countries.
Good plan. So tell me about your job. What's your job title?
So I'm an SVP of Software Engineering in Trilogy, and that means I look after a series of teams that are focused in different areas. So one of those teams is working with Crossover and WorkSmart and adding AI capabilities into it. We're introducing your personal context or your work context into those tools so they know about the meetings you've had and the decisions that have been made, and they can make informed decisions and provide informed guidance rather than just generic information.
That sounds like it would be incredibly useful for the end user as well, giving them the collective view of what they've spent their time working on and stitching together topics that might have been disconnected on different channels.
Oh, totally. We see recall as quite a challenge when you're working in a fast-paced environment, and being able to look back at the decisions that have been made over time is really helpful. WorkSmart sort of had its foundations in being more of a workforce management tool, but we see the future of it as being more around enabling people and helping them be more effective and productive. Mm. And we want to see how those capabilities can really supercharge our workforce and particularly build upon the special sauce and Crossover to help all of our people be more effective.
Mm. It's an important distinction there. WorkSmart obviously is the tool that Crossover uses for logging time and paying people for the correct number of hours. And as part of that, it's capturing their activity for every 10 minutes that they work and looking at some of the inputs, like how many keyboard strokes they did, what their active window was. One of the biggest criticisms that it's received over the years, and it's been something that's been relatively unpopular for Crossover, has been that mouse clicks and keyboard strokes aren't necessarily a complete picture of someone's effectiveness. And so what you're describing is really interesting to me as a potential solution using AI to look a lot more deeply into a person's collective work and capturing a lot more of a nuanced understanding of what they're doing, so that perhaps how many, you know, times they clicked their mouse won't be as relevant as actually what they contributed. It's an admirable reframing of the potential that a tool like WorkSmart can have to not just be keeping track of people, but empowering them.
Oh, totally. So, you know, in the past, WorkSmart is very much focused on the logging, but now we want to be able to make that data available to people so they can use their own data to help them in their day-to-day work. So that's one of our teams. Another team I've got is working on cost optimization. So we acquire companies, and one of the challenges many companies face is they use cloud providers, and cloud providers are very expensive if you aren't using them in the right way. So we've become experts in optimizing those costs, and this team is applying patterns across our entire product set to be able to reduce costs as a whole. And our third slot is focused around the new acquisition. So we recently purchased CloudSense, which is a Salesforce add-on configure price quote solution. And the role Trilogy is playing that is providing the engineering support.
So that's a very broad scope with, you know, three very different pieces making it up. That must never get boring by the sounds of it.
Oh, totally. There's a new challenge every day. And we're always looking for ways to do things one way better than we did the previous day. So although there's the three streams moving forward, there's an AI lens on everything and a process optimization lens on everything as we go.
Can you talk to me about how you use AI in your day-to-day work?
Yes. A lot of the work we do is developer-centric, so building features and fixing bugs. And so we use AI-enabled IDEs to support with that, to understand our code bases, to discover where the root cause of various challenges are or how we should do things, and to even write a lot of the code that develops those new features or makes those changes. We also use a technique called second brains, and the concept here is that AIs represent the collective generic knowledge of everyone. By forming up these second brains with our spiky points of view and our important technical decisions and the experts we rely on, we can supercharge our AI tools and get them to provide the perspectives and the insights and the direction that are aligned with our worldview. So from a management perspective, we build up these second brains and use them to enable our AI tools. And we use those AI tools in everything we do. So we use them to understand where things are working, our processes, the decisions we should make, the communications we should write throughout our day-to-day jobs. So AI has become a very important part of the company at all layers and is really the essence of how we operate today.
How do you see the optimal role of AI in terms of illuminating what actions should be taken versus being a co-pilot or versus being an assistant? Like, where do you see ultimately the role of AI being both today and then looking ahead?
So today, we see a lot of AI being driven by humans, so human in the loop. We have done quite a lot of work around fully automated bug fixes and feature work, and we achieved some good process optimizations through doing so. But it's really hard to get automated bug fixes above around 15% mm-hmm. with the technology as it exists today. We fully expect in the future, a lot of work will be fully managed by AI. And the sorts of work a human will do won't be so much in the nature of, I want to make this fix in this file, or I want to do this specific thing, but humans will become orchestrators. You know, I want to achieve this business outcome. Or, you know, I want this product to do this for our customers so that they're setting the direction and guiding the AI, but the AI is then figuring out all of the detail below that. Mm-hmm. And at the moment, a lot of what it can do is at the lowest level, around the code, but we see increasingly that will move further up as it becomes more capable. And we look really forward to the day that being an engineer isn't writing code, but being an engineer is more around understanding the customer and understanding the product and translating that into a way that the AI can achieve really good outcomes.
It seems that someone who prefers to have their head down and follow orders, execute, write code, might have a harder time transitioning, but if you're motivated by helping people and making stuff that works, then the world will be your oyster when that happens.
Oh, totally. You know, the role of the engineer is changing over time, as everything does at some point. And AI has really enabled these capabilities to be accessible to more people than ever before.
Inspiring words. So as a parting thought here, what's next for you? What's on your horizon besides, you know, moving to this amazing island of Malta?
Well, the current shift has been quite a recent one for me, and I think it's going to be a bit of a transition for quite a few months yet. For me, I think I'm going to become more experienced in the acquisition space. The one we're going through at the moment is my first one, and it's involved a lot of learning. I think I'll need to do that quite a few more times before I become adept at it. I'm only starting now to write my own second brains on how you do that well for engineering, but there's a lot for me to learn still in that space.
You're very modest. I have a hunch that you'll be running the shop in no time.
I think there's quite a way before that happens.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me to your amazing apartment here in Malta.
And thanks for coming, Andrew. It's been a pleasure meeting you.